God, we thank you for this time in this place to honor you, to glorify you, to remember everything that Christ has done for us. God, we lay our lives down just as you have laid it down for us, and we try to pick up only what it is that you have for us. Help us to glorify and honor you this evening in your son's name. Amen. So we will do feel the nails. And when we do this, I want you guys to, Jan had given this to me before our dinner. And she, this is huge. You should also have a nail that is about this size that we will put in our cross later. This, can you imagine Jesus being put on the cross and the nail going into his hands, pounded in over and over and over? Just putting it like this hurts, let alone that. As you listen to the feel of the nails, try the best you can to just even think about the pain that Christ went through for us.
Tell me Jesus died for my transgressions, that he paid that price a long, long time ago, when he gave his life for me on a hill called Calvary. But there's something else I want to know. Does he still feel the nails every time I fail? Can he hear the crowd cry, crucify again? Am I causing him pain? Then I know I'm got to change. I just can't bear the thought of hurting you. It seems that I'm so good at breaking promises, and I treat his precious grace so carelessly. Each time he forgives, what if he relives the agony he felt on that tree? Does he still feel the nails every time I fail? Does he hear the crowd cry, crucify again? Am I causing him pain? Then I know I've got to change, 'cause I just can't bear the thought of hurting him. Thank you.
Father's love for us. How vast beyond all measure that He should give His only Son and make a wretch His treasure. How great the pain of searing loss. The Father turns His face away as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon the cross, my sin upon his shoulder. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me to life. I know that it is finished.
A little bit different this evening, as you have figured out already. And starting with the understanding that we don't have our candles lit. Starting with the understanding that I did not walk up from the back. With things a little bit different. Because I don't want us to be in a routine such that we don't understand the difference in this service this evening. It is far different than a Sunday morning. It's far different when we recognize that we are here not for a celebration yet. That happens on Sunday. We are here to recognize all that Christ has given to us, all that He did for us, and the death that happened before the resurrection. For these candles will be the only light that we have. And when they are out, we recognize the darkness until Christ comes again on Sunday. We'll get to say, he is risen indeed, but not yet. Sometimes churches jump from Holy Week and they skip over Maundy, Thursday, and Good Friday, and then they hit Sunday and they don't understand the price that was paid, the price that was paid when Jesus came and washed the feet of his disciples, when he served them communion, understanding that it was the last time on earth that they would do that, that he would do that. And when I say churches don't understand, I don't necessarily mean the church themselves. I mean the people who skip the Holy Week service. So I really appreciate the fact that you are all here. This evening, we're going to walk through John 18 and John 19, which is the story of Maundy, Thursday, and Good Friday before we have Easter Sunday. And we have several readings that will happen. And in the middle, we will have communion. We will have a little bit of music. And don't get lost in all of that. Focus on what people are saying, because this is the scripture, the story of what happened with Christ. And then I invite you before Sunday to revisit it again, maybe tomorrow, for John 18 and 19. Read it again yourselves. It is very powerful. Each time there is a reader, I will extinguish a candle, recognizing that eventually Christ dies on the cross when the last candle is out. That's representation of the death. And then we will also put nails on the cross, and we will darken the church after that. Beginning with the reading from John 18, verses 1 through 11. When Jesus had finished praying, he left with his disciples, and they crossed the Kidron Valley. On the other side, there was a garden. Jesus and his disciples went into it. Jesus knew the place. He was going to hand Jesus over to his... Judas knew the place. He was going to hand Jesus over to his enemies. Jesus had often met in that place with his disciples, and so Judas came to the garden. He was guiding a group of soldiers and some officials. The chief priests and the Pharisees had sent them. They were carrying torches, lanterns, and weapons. Jesus knew everything that was going to happen to him, and so he went out and he asked them, "Who do you want?" "Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "I am he," he said. Judas, who was going to hand Jesus over, was standing there with them, and when Jesus said, "I am he," they moved back, and then they fell to the ground, and he asked them again, "What do you want?" "Jesus of Nazareth," they said, and Jesus answered, "I told you that I am he. For you, if you are looking for me, then let all of these other men go." This happened so that the words Jesus had spoken would come true. He had said, "I have not lost anyone God has given me," from John 6, verse 39. Simon Peter had a sword and pulled it out. He struck the high priest's slave and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus, and Jesus commanded Peter, "Put your sword away. Shouldn't I drink the cup of suffering the Father has given me?" And the world started to grow dim.
Then the company of soldiers, the commander, and the guards from the Jewish leaders took Jesus into custody. They bound him and led him first to Annas, who was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, the high priest that year. Caiaphas was the one who had advised the Jewish leaders that it was better for one person to die for the people.
And still the light grew dim.
Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Because this other disciple was known to the high priest, he went with Jesus into the high priest's courtyard. However, Peter stood outside near the gate. Then the other disciple, the one known to the high priest, came out and spoke to the woman stationed at the gate, and she brought Peter in. The servant woman stationed at the gate asked Peter, "Aren't you one of this man's disciples?" "I'm not," he replied. The servants and the guards had made a fire because it was cold. They were standing around it, warming themselves. Peter joined them there, standing by the fire and warming himself.
And the light of the world continued to grow dim.
Meanwhile, the chief priests questioned Jesus about his disciples and his teaching. Jesus answered, "I've spoken only to the world. I've always taught in synagogues and in the temple. Where all the Jews gather? I've said nothing in private. Why ask me? Ask those who heard what I told them. They know what I said." After Jesus spoke, one of the guards standing there slapped Jesus in the face. "Is that how you would answer a high priest?" he asked. Jesus replied, "If I speak wrongly, testify about that I was wrong. but if I speak correctly, why do you strike me? Then Annas sent him, bound to Caiaphas the high priest.
And the light continues to grow dim.
Meanwhile, Simon Peter was still standing with the guards, warming himself. They asked, "Aren't you one of his disciples?" Peter denied it, saying, "I'm not. A servant of the high priest, a relative of the one whose ear Peter had cut off, said to him, 'Didn't I see you in the garden with him?'" Peter denied it again, and immediately a rooster crowed.
And the light continued to grow dim. Let us prepare our hearts for communion. At this time, we're going to take communion. It is a condensed, shortened version of what you would usually experience on Sunday morning. This is the time and the place where we remember what Christ did for his disciples on that Last Supper. During that time, they were all gathered together, and Jesus had washed their feet, which was quite the task because this was supposed to be for the lowest servant that there was. And there were some that questioned, "Why would you wash my feet?" In fact, we used to, there was one time when I was here that we did a washing of the feet, and we only did it once. You guys may have done it a few times before I was here, and we've also done it in other churches that I have served. But one of the things that definitely is common among is people say, "I don't know that I want you to wash my feet." Because it is something, if you think about it, your feet are probably filled with germs and with dirt. And if you had to travel with just sandals on a regular basis, they were definitely filthy. And this is what Jesus did. He said, let me serve you. And in fact, he not only washed their feet, he then served the last meal. And then he went to the cross in serving all of us. So tonight, we take communion together in remembrance of what Christ has done for us. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread and he blessed it. Gracious God, King of the universe, creator of all things, creator of the bread and of the fruit, God, we come together knowing all that Christ did, knowing that we could not do it for ourselves, and we are thankful, we are grateful, but we are also in a time and a place where we understand that our sins cause the pain. And yet, we just can't help but sin. We are broken people. And God, we give you thanks for Jesus the Christ. We give you thanks for provision. We give you thanks for protection. We give you thanks for guidance. Amen. When Jesus was done giving thanks for the meal, he broke the bread. And he said, This is my body, broken for you and for the many. I've said this before, and I'm prompted to say it now. How many understood what he meant? I mean, we sit here, and do we really understand? By the time that we get through this service, it will be darkened, and our souls will feel different. Because we will understand that Christ gave all. It's as much as we can understand. But certainly the disciples at that time, when they had this meal with Jesus, did not understand his body given for them and for us and for the many. And after the meal, he took the cup and he said, This is my blood shed for you and for the many. And every time you take of this bread and you drink of this cup, you do this in remembrance of me until I come again. At this time, I'm asking Teresa to help, and this is the Lord's table. We will come row by row to the altar, and as you come, be with your Lord for as long as you would like. Adam, I'm going to ask if you have some quiet music to play. And let's start with the first three rows over here and the first three rows. I think we've got enough room. Come to the table. Sister, this is Christ's body broken for you. My sister, this is Christ's body broken for you. My sister, this is Christ's body broken for you. My sister, this is Christ's body broken for you. My brother, this is Christ's body broken for you.
Jewish leaders took Jesus from Caiaphas to the place of the Roman governor. By now it was early morning, and to avoid ceremonial uncleanness, they did not enter the palace because they wanted to be able to eat. Passover. So Pilate came out to them and asked, "What charges are you bringing against this man?" "If he were not a criminal," they replied, "we would not have handed him over to you." Pilate said, "Take him yourselves and judge him by your own law." "But we have no right to execute anyone," they objected. This took place to fulfill what Jesus had said about the kind of death he was going to die.
Then Pilate went back into his headquarters and called for Jesus to be brought to him. "Are you the King of the Jews?" he asked. Jesus replied, "Is this your own question, or did others tell you about me?" "Am I a Jew?" Pilate retorted. "Your own people and their leading priests brought you to me for trial. Why? What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not an earthly kingdom. If it were, my followers would have fought to keep me from being handed over to the Jewish leaders. My kingdom is not of this world." Pilate said, "Are you a king?" Jesus responded, "You say I am a king. Actually, I was born and came into the world to testify to the truth. All who love the truth recognize that what I say is true." "What is truth?" Pilate asked. Then he went out again to the people and told them, "He is not guilty of any crime."
"But you have a custom of asking me to release one prisoner each year at Passover. Would you like me to release this King of Jews?" But they shouted back, "No, not this man. We want Barabbas."
Then Pilate took Jesus and had him whipped. The soldiers twisted thorns together to make a crown. They put it on Jesus' head. Then they put a purple robe on him. They went up to him again and again. They kept saying, "We honor you, King of the Jews," and they slapped him in the face. Once more, Pilate came out. He said to the Jews gathered there, "Look, I am bringing Jesus out to you. I want to let you know that I find no basis for a charge against him. Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Then Pilate said to them, "Here is the man." As soon as the chief priests and their officials saw him, they shouted, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" But Pilate answered, "You take him and crucify him. I myself find no basis for a charge against him." The Jewish leaders replied, "We have a law. That law says he must die. He claimed to be the Son of God." When Pilate heard that, he was even more afraid. He went back inside the palace. "Where do you come from?" he asked Jesus, but Jesus did not answer him. "Do you refuse to speak to me?" Pilate said. "Don't you understand? I have the power to set you free or to nail you to a cross." Jesus answered, "You were given power from heaven. If you weren't, you would have no power over me. So the one who handed me over to you is guilty of a greater sin."
And from John 19:12-16. From then on, Pilate tried to set Jesus free, but the Jewish leaders kept shouting, "If you let this man go, you are no friend of Caesar. Anyone who claims to be a king opposes Caesar." When Pilate heard this, he brought Jesus out and sat down on the judge's seat at a place known as the stone pavement, which is Aramaic, which means Gabbatha in Aramaic. It was the day of preparation of the Passover, and it was about noon. "Here is your king," Pilate said to the Jews. But they shouted, "Take him away, take him away, crucify him." "Shall I crucify your king?" Pilate asked. "We have no king but Caesar," the chief priests answered. Finally, Pilate handed him over to them to be crucified. And still, the light continued to grow dim.
Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Oh, sometimes it causes me to tremble, tremble, tremble. Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Were you there when they nailed him to the tree? Were you there when they nailed him to the tree? Ah, sometimes it causes me to tremble, tremble, oh, tremble. Were you there when they were you there when they laid him in the tomb? Were you there when they laid him in the tomb? Oh, sometimes it comes.
carrying his cross by himself, he went out to a place called Skull Place in Aramaic Golgotha. That's where they crucified him and two others with him, one on each side and Jesus in the middle. Pilate had a public notice written and posted on the cross. It read, "Jesus the Nazarene, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this sign, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Aramaic, Latin, and Greek. Therefore, the Jewish chief priests complained to Pilate, "Don't write the King of the Jews, but this man said, 'I am the King of the Jews.'" Pilate answered, "What I've written, I've written."
And still the darkness continued to come upon us.
When the soldiers crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and his sandals and divided them into four shares, one for each soldier. His shirt was seamless, woven as one piece from the top to the bottom. They said to each other, "Let's not tear it. Let's cast lots to see who will get it." This was to fulfill the scripture, "They divided my clothes among themselves, and they cast lots for my clothing." That's what the soldiers did.
The darkness continued to come upon us.
Standing near the cross were Jesus' mother and his mother's sister Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother standing there beside the temple, standing there beside the disciple he loved, he said to her, "Dear woman, here is your son." And he said to this disciple, "Here is your mother." And from then on, this disciple took her into his home.
And the darkness continued to come upon us.
Later, knowing that everything had now been finished, and so that the scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, "I am thirsty." A jar of wine vinegar was there, so they soaked the sponge in it, put the sponge on a stalk of the hyssop plant, and lifted it to Jesus' lips. When he had received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." With that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit.
And Jesus died for all. From John 19:31-37, it was preparation day. The next day would be a special Sabbath. The Jewish leaders did not want the bodies left on the crosses during the Sabbath day, and so they asked Pilate to have the legs broken and the bodies taken down. The soldiers came and broke the legs of the first man who had been crucified with Jesus. And then he broke the legs of the other man, but when they came to Jesus, they saw that he was already dead. So they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers struck his spear into the side of Christ. Right away, blood and water flowed out. The man who saw it had been a witness about it. And when he had said, what he had said is true, he knows that he tells the truth. He is a witness so that you also may believe. These things happen in order that scripture would come true. And it says, "Not one of his bones will be broken." As recorded in Exodus 12, verse 46, Numbers 9, verse 12, Psalm 34, verse 20. Scripture also says from Zechariah 12, verse 10, "They will look to the one who they have pierced." At this time, we're going to have a video of a song by the name, it's called Forgiven. And as we do that, would you carefully proceed to put your nail in the cross and then go back in quiet reflection as the song finishes.
Thank you. cold between my fingertips. I've hidden in the garden. I've denied you with my very lips. God, I fall down to my knees with a hammer in my hand. Do you look at me? Arms open. Forgiven, forgiven. Child, there is freedom from all of it. Say goodbye to every sin. You are forgiven. I've done things I wish I hadn't done. I've seen things I wish I hadn't seen. Just the thought of your amazing grace. And I cried, Jesus, forgive me. God, I fall down to my knees with a hammer in my hand. You look at me, arms open. Forgiven, forgiven. Child, there is freedom from all of it. Say goodbye to every sin. You are forgiven. Could have been 6 feet under. I could have been lost forever. Yeah, I should be in that fire. But now there's fire inside of me. Here I am, a dead man walking. No grave gonna hold God's people. All the weight of all our evil lifted away, forever free. Who could believe? Who could believe?
From John 19, verses 38 through 42. Later, Joseph asked Pilate for Jesus' body. Joseph was from the town of Arimathea. He was a follower of Jesus, but he followed Jesus secretly because he was afraid of the Jewish leaders. After Pilate gave him permission, Joseph came and took the body away. Nicodemus went with Joseph. He was the man who had earlier visited Jesus at night. Nicodemus brought some mixed spices that weighed about 75 pounds. The two men took Jesus' body and they wrapped it in strips of linen cloth along with the spices. That was the way that the Jews buried people. At the time where Jesus was crucified, there was a garden. A new tomb was there. No one had ever been put in it before. That day was the Jewish preparation day, and the tomb was nearby. And so they placed Jesus there. You've been given some cloths that will darken the church a little bit more. And after we have all darkened the different spots that we have, I want you to come back to your seat, and I'm going to shut the lights off for some quiet, just a few moments of quiet reflection. because I really don't believe that we take the time, myself included, that we take enough time to understand what Christ has done. At the time that he gave up his life on the cross, there was darkness, there was an earthquake, and the veil was torn in two. A whole new way was about to happen, a whole new way for each one of us. Let us embrace what happened in that moment before we get to the resurrected King on Sunday. So for those of you that have the cloths, I invite you to put them. I believe you have some a label that says where it will go. And so I invite you to come do that now while we maybe have some quiet music in the background. And now, go in peace. May Jesus Christ, who for our sake became obedient unto death, even death on a cross, keep you and strengthen you this night and forever. Amen. Mm-hmm.